Hi, everyone, and welcome to another episode of She Plays Games, the podcast where we celebrate women in the video games industry. I'm your host, Lauren, and I've been working as a journalist and content creator in the games industry for the last 10 years. On my show, I have a chat with women of many different roles in the games industry, whether it's journalism, games development, or even streaming. My goal is to give visibility to the many women in video games with the hopes to inspire a new generation of women in gaming. In terms of announcements, today is International Women's Day, which is such an important day for women around the world. For our part, we've launched the SPG 100, which is a list of 100 incredible women in the video games industry. I want to give a big congratulations to all the women who made it into this year's list. And of course, if you haven't already, please be sure to send your love to any woman in the games industry that you feel deserves more visibility. If you want to see the full SPG 100, then be sure to head on over to the site sheplaysgames.co. On today's episode, I'm speaking with Haley Uris. Haley is the brand communications director at Tonic Games Group, who have become a huge name in the world of video gaming thanks to the release of Fall Guys. Throughout this episode, we talk about Haley's journey into the gaming industry and how persistence and creating foundations really pay off. I hope you enjoy listening to Haley's story, and if you like what I do, please be sure to subscribe to me on your chosen platform, and if you also wouldn't mind leaving me a review, it would really help me out. This is episode 39 of She Plays Games. Haley, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Happy to be here.
It must have just been such an incredible year for you in 2020. Not necessarily in terms of like freaking COVID, but in terms of the actual thing you do, which is marketing.
Don't think that I have ever had quite a year like this. It's been beyond like any marketer's wildest hopes and dreams, I think.
Yeah. And it's like this weird sort of conflicted thing where it's like 2020 is like the best year, but also like the not so great year as well. It's just like but like Fall Guys, man, that is that is a game, and that was an experience. I think you got most people through their lockdown, like, honestly.
If that's, like, one thing that we can contribute, that would be the best thing. Because, obviously, like, we like making games because it makes people happy and it is ways for people to connect with each other. So, what better year than this year to do that?
Exactly. And, I mean, like, our household was no different. I have two daughters. One's 2 and 1 is 5. And my eldest has been just in love with Fall Guys. She hasn't played it herself because she's a bit too afraid. We've like we've sort of like given her the controller and been like, do you want to try? And I think she's kind of gauged that it's real people she's going up against. And she's just like, no, I don't want to do that. But she loves the like character customization and stuff. But yeah, no, I mean, we've drawn Fall Guys. We've done our own games, our own like even real life games of Egg Scramble. We have these like little Tomy squishy eggs, and we just kind of threw them on the floor. And then we would run to different corners of the house. And you'd have, by the end of the song, of the egg scramble song, that was the cutoff point. And then you had to count how many eggs you had. Allie frequently took all of them from me. I normally ended up with none.
Because definitely the best part of watching egg scramble is whether or not the other team tries to steal the eggs. So I was like, I really hope I was a component of the real life version.
Oh, completely, completely. There was a lot of arguments, a lot of, you can't hold 2 eggs because that's not real life. You have to hold 1. And it was so much fun. But Allie did have some ideas improving or expanding. She really wants fall dogs, which basically she wants not fall guys in dog costumes. She wants the jelly beans to turn into four-legged animals and chase each other. And then also she's already thought up the fact that, you know, there's the pull mechanic. So she said, well, instead of using their hands to pull people and stuff, they use their mouths.
See, very logical.
I think would make a very interesting expansion to the Fall Guys franchise, if I'm honest. But she's requested it for season 10. So if you thought
that gives us some time, then that's not too bad. Yeah.
She's just like, "Mommy, I'm really ready for Fall Guys season 10 to come out." We're just like, we're not there yet. But yeah, honestly, like, I mean, your team has been just such a great part of lockdown for us. So
that seriously means like the world to us as Mediatonic to hear, because that's 100% our goal. And it's amazing to think that like it's spurring kids on to like make their own games and enjoy things off screen as well as on screen. Like, that's so cool.
Oh, and sort of speaking of kids, I really wanted to know, like, sort of what was your journey into games? Like, what did you sort of start with when you were a kid?
I've definitely always gamed. I think the first one I ever got like super into was probably like Sonic 2. It was whatever one had like a cartridge that would sit on top of the original cartridge, and it definitely had Tails and Knuckles in it.
So good.
Back in the day. But back then I definitely didn't think it was like a career path. I just liked playing games. Like, I played Spyro probably every Christmas whenever a new one came out. Eventually, I got like a PlayStation and played a bunch of Final Fantasy. Definitely loved things like Jak and Daxter. I was always really just like into how much world building you could put into it. Like, I don't think that was a term anybody used back then either. But the ability to not only make something that's interactive and fun, but has not only like a story, but a whole like universe within it. Because before then, I'd always been super into reading. So video games obviously seemed like the next best thing, because it's like, now it's even more vivid and more alive.
Yeah, it's like, what can I do in this area? Like, you know, reading books, although it's fantastic, you can't really ask more questions or do more things with like characters. It's like, wait, why, what? Wait, no, I want to see you again. Or that type of thing. In games, you can do that, can't you?
Yeah, definitely. And you can like get a bit more of a sense of what it feels to be in that character's shoes, or to interact with the other characters if it's something bigger like Final Fantasy, for example.
Oh, I love Final Fantasy.
And then, of course, there's just like silly fun games that feel like physically good to play. So like, there's just so much variety. But I don't think it was until, gosh, probably like Fable or something like that, where I thought maybe it could be a career, because I think that was the first game where I read in magazines about like the studio behind it and the fact that there's all these people working there, but not just programmers and 3D artists and stuff like that, but also people making like the silly posters that are in the town that Fable set in.
Somebody actually sat down, thought about those.
Yeah, I was like, I could do that, because before I went into games, I was a graphic designer, because I've always been interested in both like art and writing. So going into something between like visual communications and graphic design seemed like a really good bet. And there definitely was like a games course at my university, but for whatever reason, I was like, nah, that's not like a real thing. I can't really do that.
That's hogwash, honestly.
Yeah. My 80-year-old self as a 20-year-old. Yeah.
Yeah. I know. Kids, really.
For real. And then I started to investigate it a little bit more, and my degree for undergrad was quite open, because basically like every 2 weeks we would just pick a problem that we wanted to solve and then write up a brief of how we were going to do it. So you could do anything from like design a website mock-up to build a 3D museum exhibit to all sorts of things. So I started making a lot of my projects about games. Like, I think one of my bigger ones was about a VR game on how to increase your emotional intelligence or something.
Oh, cool.
So I was like, maybe I could make this into a career. And I started to read more about different studios across the world. And unfortunately, in the US, they're all in California. And I was living in the East Coast. But then I studied abroad in London. And I realized how big of a games community there is over here. And when I worked basically for 1 or 2 years as a graphic designer, thankfully at Hasbro Toys. So that was super fun.
Yeah, that would have been, because I saw that you did, what was it? Was it Strawberry Shortcake or something like that? You did some of the boxes for? That's so cool.
British people are always like, I have never heard of this brand before. I was like, yeah, it's a really, really ancient brand in the US.
Yeah. But I totally remember little children who were like dressed up like cakes. It's amazing.
Exactly. And like just walking to Hasbro every day was great because there's like giant Star Wars replica figures and stuff like that, like as soon as you walk in. So it's just a fun place to work anyways. And obviously they have their own, you know, games branch as well. So it was kind of like a pre-working in the games industry, I'd say, because it's very similar to how we work now. And similar type of roles and things like that as well. But I was like, yeah, I really want to try this whole games thing. Like, I think I could probably find my way in there somehow. And at the same time, I was like, and I really miss London. Like, I really like studying abroad there. It seems like it has an amazing creative industries, like, vibe to it. The government actually supports the creative industries. And it was really, like, close-knit in regards to the UK companies that are over here. So I decided to come back. And I did a master's in game design and started making my connections with the people that set up that program and doing like little tiny bits of freelance work way back then to try to see if I could find my way into the industry, basically.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's something that's quite common because there isn't really a set way to get into the industry. Like, it's just, you just kind of find your way there. You keep trying things, don't you? And then all of a sudden the planets align and all of a sudden you have a job in the industry and you're just like,
it's happening.
But yeah, it is weird, actually, like getting back to the American thing, because I'm from Pennsylvania.
Okay.
And America, like, always is seen as like the land of opportunity, but you're so right in the sense that it's so central to one area of the country, like particularly for games. Like, I mean, even theater, most of my friends who were in university with me for theater had moved out to California.
Yeah.
And I think that there's something about the UK, especially as I've lived here for a while now, like, It does feel really, I don't know, it just feels really linked together nicely. Like, it feels, I know obviously it's big, but it feels really small in comparison. And you feel like you can make a difference a lot more over here than I feel like I did in America. Does that make sense?
Yeah, definitely. And I think it feels just a bit more cooperative as well, because I think over here, there's a bit more of a balance between a wide variety of sizes of companies, whereas in the US, it's so mostly AAA, because obviously, you know, when you're creating an indie company in the US, like, you're literally kind of putting your life on the line.
You so are. I mean, like, having to worry about health insurance alone is just, I think it really is such a disadvantage for creativity in the States, unfortunately.
Like, absolutely.
I think the way that, obviously, like, the UK isn't perfect, but I feel like the way in which the country runs, it allows for so much more, like, hope and optimism that you can actually do something, rather than in the States where you're just constantly worried about getting sick and then
the
losing
whole surviving
everything.
Thing, yeah.
Yeah, like, it's just so weird. But either way, yeah, I mean, it's incredible. And do you feel like now that you're in sort of the marketing side of the industry, do you feel like it, having that game design background, has allowed you to do your job in a different way.
Yeah, absolutely. I think I have like a weird trifecta of everything I'd done before games and how that has helped a ton actually getting into games. Because I would say even like my graphic design experience, and I've also done an MBA, so I have some like more businessy, corporate-y stuff as well. I say very, you know, eloquently.
Officially. Yeah.
And all of those things have really helped, especially because I started indie side, where you have to wear like a whole like smorgasbord of hats, let alone a few of them.
Yeah.
But I think particularly with the game design, one is that like it allows you to understand how different disciplines within your studio work. So you can find like more efficient ways to work with each other, because obviously it's kind of like all chaos all the time and everybody's always busy. So you don't want to be the marketer who's nagging everybody for assets or things like that. Like you want to find a way that it works really closely together, and so that you're working together as a team instead of having this like separate division of like marketing, publishing and development. Because it's so much better for the game that way. And I think the second thing is that the games that I've seen that do the best, besides just being good games, is that the alignment of the game itself has been so closely tied to a set of pillars, basically, which can start out in game design, but very much turn out to be your marketing pillars as well, or branding pillars, or community pillars. Yeah. Like they all really link together. And having gone through a game design degree and understanding, you know, how they're coming at it and the way that they're thinking about it and investigating all sorts of different types of games and genres and things like that really helps to make sure that you're fully synced up with the design team and that all of the comms and everything set up around the game will hopefully give the players the clearest picture possible.
Yeah, that is like the sort of truest thing about it is like, you know, because ultimately that is your job, isn't it? It is to make sure that people know exactly what they're getting with your game so that when they do get the game, they are just as excited as when you first sort of spoke about it. And it's really fascinating to sort of think about, you know, learning how to make a game and learning what cogs go into a game. It really does make you more effective in how you know where things sort of go and who to talk to and and what goes where and who needs what and that sort of thing. But I think that is so true, like how important it is, because, you know, you see a lot of companies who do struggle with like the community aspect particularly and understanding sort of what the fans want out of their experience with the studio. Mm-hmm. Like, so many times it's always like, you know, well, why did they make that decision? Why did they do this? And why did they do that? And like, it's almost like this weird miscommunication between marketing and fans and the game itself. And, I think that that's really cool that you focus on fusing everything and creating a unity between all the parts.
Yeah, you definitely end up being like a bit of a bridge and a translator between players and the development team. And the more you can understand both sides of that, the better and easier. Well, the easier it will be for you, but the better experience it will be for the players, which is obviously more important.
Yeah.
As soon as you go into marketing or start talking to marketing people, like the most used phrase is like managing expectations.
Yes.
But obviously, like, we just want to, there's a lot of constraints that come out with creating something technological, especially when you're combining it with creativity, because you're trying to, you know, squeeze somebody's giant idea of what's going to be fun or intriguing or engaging into something that has very strict constraints. So there's always going to be a push and pull effect, and it's, you know, the marketing team or the community team, anybody who does the external comms, that has to figure out a way to explain that in a way that players will understand and hopefully not just like logically, but also emotionally.
What was the meeting like when you guys came up with the Yidus or with the big hammer?
Hilarious. I was not on the original meeting of creating the big hammer. However, I can say that I have had to correct many a very senior and corporate person through various partnerships about what the names are, which is like the most hilarious part of my job.
Like how many spelling errors?
Actually, it's yeetus is like a yeetus thing that I've had to say.
Actually. I love it. Oh, that's great. Oh, and I mean, considering all the aspects of your role, I mean, like you said, you're doing like graphic design, you're doing content like copy and all these sort of things. What would you say is like your favorite thing about your job that you get to do?
Oh, man, there's definitely a lot.
Yeah.
And it's, I think it's also evolved over the years as well, because if you had asked me like 2 or 3 years ago, I probably would have said part of it would have been creating some of the actual marketing assets, because at smaller teams, I used to have to do that myself. But now I think, I'm trying to think of like what I've done the past year, I think one part is that figuring out how to work efficiently and connect with the people in our studio. Like all the people I work with are amazing and I love working with them. And I know we're all working at 110% and we're putting everything into the game. And I'm at a stage, hopefully, where I can now be the person that eases things for both my marketing team and the development team. So trying to work with all these really complex issues, but with amazing people has been really rewarding. And then from like a more strict marketing standpoint, I think I'm fallen back in love with brand, because when I started out in graphic design, I always kind of really loved doing identity design. Like one of the first things I worked on when I worked at Hasbro was trying to revitalize the logo that they had for it. Unfortunately, it never came to fruition because they canceled the project.
Oh, no.
But I did like hundreds and hundreds of logo studies. And I did that on Sunless Skies when I worked at Fail Better as well. And I've always kind of liked that, trying to find visual symbolism and communicating that through logos and branding and things like that. But at Mediatonic, and certainly with Fall Guys, it's been great to work more on like the overarching brand and figuring out how it's going to stretch the more the game grows, or the more that we start, you know, like, do we want to do merch? What happens if, you know, 10 years from now, Netflix come up and they're like, hey, we want to do a Fall Guys TV series. Like, how does the universe survive when it's stretched across different mediums? And what is at its core? How do we make those really, thankfully, very clear design pillars that the team have set up, and, you know, expand it in a way that it still feels authentic to itself?
Absolutely. And I think like, yeah, it does. It is freaking like, you know, when something's about Fall Guys, like it's just, it's so specific. Like obviously like bright colors, you know, we've seen a lot of different sort of franchises use a lot of bright, vivid colors. But for some reason with Fall Guys, you just know, you just know. And it's proven from all the hard work that you all have done on giving this such a specific identity. Like there is no mistaking a Fall Guy. There is no mistaking now, like this is Fall Guys and this is not, you know.
Like the best thing to hear. And actually, yeah. And you say that with a color palette, because I think, well, I mean, our art team would definitely be delighted to hear that. But it's, Mediatonic have a soft spot for rainbows anyway, so there was a good chance that no matter what we did, it would be pretty brightly colored. But in regards to the Fall Guys palette, specifically, our artists work on the fact that the colors should look edible and delicious.
I love that.
So like a lot of the color palettes have like food names, and even like when they're designing the original costumes for like season one, a lot of them were like kind of food centric. But it also goes into like the color palette for the obstacle courses and everything as well. So yeah, I think that's one of the, like, even just on the art side, there was such a clear vision of, you know, the visual representation of the brand should look edible and tasty.
I know, my daughter always loved the weenie costume, the hot dog costume. She just
it is just definitely one of the favorites of all time.
I mean, you can't knock a good weenie costume.
No. It's still my favorite part of the trailer that it's in, so.
Oh, that's good. That's good. She's on the right track then.
Yep.
So, I mean, you know, I through looking through your sort of history, you actually did work at Mediatonic for a little bit as a intern, sort of, well, a few years ago, and then you came back. Was it sort of the feeling of the company that brought you back to it, or like how much had it changed in that time? Like, what was the sort of thing there?
Yeah, it's crazy to think of back in those days, because it both feels like it was ancient history, but also it wasn't actually that long ago.
Yeah. Yeah. 2014 feels like an absolute age.
Century. Yeah. Yeah. It was the first like proper games studio experience that I had, because it was my first like proper in studio job or internship, as opposed to the freelance work I've been doing. And hilariously, actually, before I got the internship, I had been interviewed for a game design position, but unfortunately I didn't get it. But it was clear, like, I felt like we were like vibing. Like, I was like, I know I fit like in this company somehow. Maybe it's not like a game designer, but like there must be somewhere. So I kept kind of like occasionally messaging one of the co-founders, Paul, be like, so do you have any internships? And we had this kind of tie because both co-founders went to Brunel University, which is where I got my master's. So they had sent, I think he was a writer at the time, one of their senior writers, to kind of be an industry panel for when we presented our games at the end of our course. So that's kind of how I got kind of tagged for the interview. And that didn't unfortunately work out. But then I tried to do my MBA and I was like, I think the thing that I'm missing is in regards to getting into the games industry is that I don't have any real like in studio experience yet. Mm-hmm. So I somehow convinced Paul to let me be an intern.
You will accept me.
Yeah.
I love it.
So I did like, I was like a QA and production intern so that I could like see how those systems worked within the studio. And I did a lot of testing for a game they did at the time called Heaven Strike Rivals, which was adorable and very steampunky, which I loved. And then I think they had just started working on the Had a Full Boyfriend Western release, like right when I was leaving. But I think even back then it was an interesting like growth period for the company, because I did my internship kind of in two parts around my degree. So the first part that I did in the first semester, I was on a team of maybe like 10 people that had one producer. And then when I came back for the second part, the team had grown to 30 people and had like four producers. And that was just for one of the titles that they were working on.
And that's like not even like, that was a short space of time. And that's even like before like the massiveness that is Fall Guys and like how fast they were growing even then.
100%. Yeah. And like at that point, you know, the company was still doing a lot of work for hire. So there were a few different mobile games, I think, that they had in development. They were working on the Had a Full Western release. They were doing Heaven Strike Rivals with Square Enix, which was probably one of their first like bigger partnered games. But yeah, it was already growing rapidly. And yeah, it was within an academic year. So, you know, less than a full annual year. But yeah, not only from the interview and feeling like I was kind of like vibing with the company culture and stuff like that, but you know, once I did intern there and I met more of the people and got to work with them day by day, I was just like so floored with how nice and like wholesome and like amazing everybody was. Like, it didn't matter if it was a co-founder or a senior or somebody who'd come in to intern like I did. Like, everybody treated you with the same amount of respect and like engagement and tried to get you like to play card games with them at lunch or like the newest board game or whatever. And like, there was, yeah, just such a like community vibe to it. And I think it meshed really well with not only just like a personal level, but also I really respected the work that they did too. And that really like attracted me, because sometimes with indie games, it can be so unstable, because you're kind of chasing a dream, which is beautiful, but not always like the most financially sound.
Yeah, I know.
But Mediatonic always seemed to have like a really nice production pipeline that made everything feel like there was sense in the world still, and had always been really smart about business decisions and, you know, really just like hungry for knowledge. Like if they didn't know how to do something, they'd go out and they'd try it on the next game to kind of like master the next thing. And I was like, that's a really good balance of like where I might want to work, because they both have like the creativity and like that wholesome community vibe, but they also are ambitious and they want to try new things and like they want to keep improving. And I was like, that's a really nice middle ground.
Yeah. And it's also really nice that they, I mean, I know obviously like you kept reminding them of your existence.
They didn't have a choice, yeah.
But it is also nice that they gave you, I mean, you earned it, but like they allowed you to have that opportunity to join because they could see how passionate and sort of like just they could see the spark in you, in the sense that like you were somebody who was really passionate about their brand and about their studio. Like I think that's something that a lot of the times can really sort of, you know, there's times where people can really get hurt back when like sort of like senpai yeah. notice me type of thing, you know, like when studios kind of look the other way. You always hear about like stories where people get rejected, but like I think that must have been an amazing moment for you to be able to have that opportunity to work for them, a place that you actually like really 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 loved to work at, especially.
Absolutely. And it was just, it did feel a bit like when I returned this time, like coming home. Yeah. Even though I'd only spent like a year there, but you know, even 6 years after the fact, a lot of the same people that I worked with back then were still at the company, which is always, you know, a great sign.
Yeah.
And yeah, it felt amazing to be back. And I was just super excited when I saw them put the marketing job up, actually, because I did kind of follow up with Paul throughout the years and just be like, are you sure you don't want to hire a marketing person yet? That's kind of what I've ended up doing. I could do it for you guys.
Yeah.
But it wasn't the right time. And then finally, 2 years ago, almost to this day, they hired me to do marketing. And I was the first ever marketing hire for the company at all, which still kind of blows my mind.
Yeah. How? Like, beautiful boyfriend alone? That was like a huge, like sort of crazy thing to happen. Like, how did they lasted this long without marketing?
It is, I think, like, both co-founders, you know, are coming at it from a really like great business perspective, and they have a bit of, you know, their own marketing experiences, and they obviously have a great team of people that, you know, have worked with them from a commercial side as well internally to get those products out there. But because we've worked with such amazing partners over the years, like Microsoft, for example, you know, we've been able to focus basically on developing the games, and then they've taken over the community and the marketing work. And that definitely made sense, because obviously if you have somebody like Microsoft that you're making a game with, you know that they have like a legion of marketing people. Yeah. And resources. Yeah. Of course you'd want that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, so currently obviously you're director, communications director essentially at Mediatonic, and things have changed though significantly, like sort of last year with COVID happening. And one of the things you did as marketing manager at the time was like arranging sort of handling events and stuff for people to come see the games. I mean, how has this sort of changed how you market games with Mediatonic, and like how do you think it's gonna sort of change things for the foreseeable future?
It definitely made us all have to put our thinking caps on, that's for sure.
Yeah.
It's crazy to me, because actually the last thing I did in the before times was to bring Fall Guys to
BC. Yeah. It's the new BC.
Was to bring Fall Guys to PAX East. So literally the last thing I did was a giant consumer event, like right when COVID was starting to enter the US. So it's just like mind-boggling to think about. But yeah, you're totally right. Like a lot of the stuff I did back then was very events focused. Like, we were getting ready to bring it to REST. We had just brought it to PAX. We also in Boston, and we also had brought it to PAX in Australia. We were planning a bunch of really fun studio events as well, because we were just about to move into our new office.
Of course,
because we had slowly been filling up our office, like, just at a ridiculous pace, to the point where I thought we might end up having, like, double-decker desks.
mega desk.
And literally the week that London officially went into lockdown was, like, the week that we were supposed to move.
Oh, my gosh.
And we had been planning a bunch of, like, you know, opening house kind of events to invite press in and all that kind of stuff. And it was so crazy to have that switch, like, just like a flick, like, all of a sudden, like, no events.
I mean,
crazy, like,
not being able to just, like, see people's reactions, like, or talk to people about the game in person. It must have just been just surreal almost.
And it even, like, affected things like PR, because back then, you know, especially those first few months of, like, proper lockdown, you know, sentiment worldwide was obviously at an all-time low. So it's not like you wanted to announce any exciting news, because it wasn't the right time to do that. You wanted to be mindful of, you know, what people are going through. But I think, you know, games have really proven how adaptable we are, and also just how important these digital communities are, because we're finding now, months and months into lockdown, that other industries are trying to, like, find ways to collaborate with us, because they see that we have, you know, Discords full of community members who are super excited about the stuff that we're excited about. And I don't think it did, because we did have a lot of events planned, but I don't think it actually was that worrisome in regards to, like, the Fall Guys marketing plan, because it was always kind of a mix between, you know, all the different layers of marketing. So there were physical events, there were digital stream events, there were, you know, advertising and PR and things like that. So we had to make some tough decisions about canceling events that we'd already started setting up, which is unfortunate. But, like, we then thankfully were able to pretty easily bring ourselves onto more digital events. And like, even from the beginning of the design, Fall Guys was meant to be streamed. Like, that's, I think, one of its best kind of, like, marketing assets, is that that was built into the design. So we could really capitalize on getting on Twitch and getting people involved to play in our first few, like, open betas. And then finally, you know, at launch, when everybody could play. So I think that it weirdly worked in our favor. I don't know. Like,
it
was partially designed, but not with COVID in mind.
But I think it's also really cool how supportive you all have been over the community as well. Like, the fact that there was that one player who's just got 3,000 crowns, and you've done so much to sort of support him and congratulate him. And then, I mean, you know, you had that that one event as well where you were raising money for charity, and you raised, like, what was the final count in the end? How much money was it?
It was $1 million, which still, like, is mind-boggling.
That's insane.
For Special Effect, which obviously, like, are a great charity, so.
Oh my gosh, they're incredible. Yeah, actually, one of the people I just spoke to was is an ambassador, Zoe Sams, for Special Effect.
And amazing.
What they do is just, they give so much hope to people
100%.
who just deserve it. Like, they deserve to have these experiences, and, like, that's just so incredible that you all were able to raise that much money. And, like, it just really seems like community is just something that is important to Mediatonic's brand, and Fall Guys particularly. Just the fact that, like, you know, you care about the people who play your game, because ultimately they're the ones that make it go and make it, like, a good place to sort of play in and be in. And I just think you're doing so well. Like, I just, you know, like, just like sitting on the outside, like, it's just, it's really incredible.
I'm really glad that comes across, because actually, like, one of our, I mean, every company these days has, like, you know, like a mission statement and brand values and stuff like that. But like, I'm one of the reasons, you know, as we were talking about, of me being so on board with coming back, is that I've always felt like I was on the same page as the company's values. And one of ours is to leave the world a little bit better than we found it. So I think, you know, like, when we're thinking about games, we really do want to both create games that are like Fall Guys, where like literally everybody can play and it's very like easy to get into. You don't need to be a super skilled player, but you, if you are, like, you can still play and get that same kind of satisfaction. And also make, you know, games like Murder by Numbers, which is for a much more niche audience, but probably a niche audience that had never had a game designed for them before. And I just love working with a bunch of people that are like constantly using all that creativity and their, you know, tech skills and everything to figure out a way to get more fun, basically, to in front of people. And obviously, I think we could all use as much of that as we can while we're all stuck inside. So,
rewarding. Yeah, I mean, it was the thing of lockdown. Like, it, having games has been just something that has given just a bit of hope. It's like, there's so much that got canceled in 2020 and so many things that people had been looking forward to that couldn't be, but games were something that just carried on. Like, it's just, you know, we can't meet together because we can't meet together for conventions or expos or anything, but we can all play games together. And like, it's horrible to say, but I'm also just kind of like, you know, I'm thankful that I can't imagine this happening like 10 years ago, you know, like if this had happened 10 years ago and we weren't like online and, well, in the same way that we are right now, I feel like this whole situation would have been a lot harder. But because it's happened now in the age of like just all of us being online together, I think that that has allowed us to cope with it a bit better. More than what it would have been like, you know, maybe not 10 years ago, because that was only 2010, wasn't it?
Oh, but God. Like,
I know, like, the time just goes, Matt. It just goes. But yeah, like, I mean, I almost feel like online, we weirdly built online enough so that it could actually sustain us during this horrible period. You know,
definitely. And yeah, 100%. Like, especially, you know, as I'm sure you know, living abroad, like, I haven't been able to travel to go see any of my friends or family back in the States. So it's been really nice on like my birthday or holidays or whatever to be able to jump on Xbox or my PC and just play with my friends back home, because it also is like a little slice of normality, because, you know, that aspect hasn't changed. Like, that could have happened before COVID too. So like, you still have that same fun dynamic and you can still laugh and, you know, get involved into what's happening on screen. Or even like when Tim the Tatman was trying to win his first crown on Fall Guys.
Yes.
Like, it felt like a sporting event, even though we're all watching it separately.
It seriously was. And I mean, like, I will admit, I still have yet to earn a crown. I don't even care anymore. Like, at the time, I was just like, you know, I haven't won a crown yet. But now I'm just kind of like, you know, it's just fun. It's just fun to play.
Exactly. And you'd be surprised at how many of us don't have crowns either, or like have fewer than you'd probably suspect that we have.
It's just, you get so close. I've gotten so close. And then it's just like, nope, the planet's in line. That's fine. That's okay. But it's still, it's like one of the few games where you can do that. And then it's just, it's okay. It's okay. Because you know what? I'll play again. And I will try again.
And you hopefully you had a laugh in the way that you failed.
Yes, absolutely. The freaking hexagon game like all of a sudden you're walking along and then all of a sudden you fall once and you think, okay, well, there's like seven levels below me. I'm definitely gonna I didn't catch one of them? What? Excuse me? You know, it's like, oh, but yeah, no, we've had some good times on Fall Guys. I mean, getting back to sort of your game design class and stuff, I mean, did you ever have sort of hopes of making your own game at any point or work like, yeah, working on making a game?
Absolutely. Like, I mean, you don't want to be the dreaded idea guy in games, but it's just such a fun thing to try to figure out, like, if you like creative problem solving and obviously games. I had to make them for my course. So
yeah,
I designed like a few really hilarious ones, and, you know, I had to get them graded and stuff, which looking back on now, like, I wish I could do all over again, cause I would have done them totally differently. But there have been one or two over the years that I've even worked on, like, at studios, because a lot of indies, you know, for example, like the first company that I worked for allowed anybody in the company to pitch a game idea. And one time when we were doing that, they selected my idea to bring forward. So actually we'd gone through like concepting it out and writing the design document and everything like that. Unfortunately that company no longer exists, but I do have the design document.
And you still have it, just precious.
Yeah, I just need, you know, lots of money and a studio, because of course it was ridiculously complicated, but it was,
of course,
it was like a Victorian room escape game, and I loved working on that.
So cool. But I must have just been so surreal to have people actually like working on something that you created, like,
definitely.
It's just, yeah, that must have been so surreal. But yeah, I would definitely just, yeah, savor that design document forever. Like, that's amazing.
Yeah, it was just, yeah, an awful around, because it was also like the people I worked with I was really close to at the time too, so it that like team environment of like creatively trying to problem solve and figure out a way past the constraints, you know, that you run into was just so much fun, and researching some of the more historical elements to fit in there and stuff like that was also great. It was basically like my dream job for like 6 months. And, you know, now and again, I also kind of like will jot down like mini game design documents as well, because I find the few times that I do kind of have that free brain space, or usually the times where I don't, my brain goes into overdrive and just thinks of all sorts of different ideas. So I have like a little journal that I keep it in, and who knows, one day. But Fall Guys has definitely been taking up my time for the past few months.
Yep. But that ideas journal, it'd just be Haley's games journal, Haley's game ideas journal.
Exactly. And one day, who knows what strange concoction I could bring into the world.
Oh, it'd be amazing. And I mean, with Fall Guys as well, I mean, I remember, yeah, literally everybody on Twitch playing it. I just wanted to know, like, how did you all sort of cope with such a huge influx of audience in such like a short space of time?
It was definitely like beyond our wildest expectations, because I think, you know, like, we did have an inkling that it would be a hit, and, you know, especially on the marketing side, we had that feeling like the stars were aligning for this to do, you know, really, really well. But there's no way we could imagine like quite the numbers that we got to the point where I think, what was it? The Game Dev Hero Awards were around that time. And I had just written a submission for our community manager, Oliver, for the marketing award. And I included like the current stats that we had in that for like how much he'd grown our social media following and stuff like that. But it was before the official release of Fall Guys. So then when it turned out that he had won that category, and, you know, the panel were reviewing the candidates and stuff like that, the person who runs the awards had to make a note that was like, just so you know, Haley wrote this submission before Fall Guys launched, and now they literally have like a million followers. So don't be surprised that it says 10,000 followers on Twitter or something, like, which seems ridiculous, you know, back then, but is now
yeah,
like, mind-blowing.
Oh, I'd love it though. Oh,
and
you should just save it forever.
It definitely made me chuckle. I don't know, like, thankfully we all can rely on each other, and like our partners, Devolver, who published the game, have been amazing as well. So we've been able to lean on them or vice versa throughout the process. And I think that's helped a lot to have that kind of like emotional support, and for all of us to kind of be amazed. Because definitely let me tell you, like during the Battle of the Brands, where, you know, we were raising that $1 million for special effect, like none of us thought it was going to be like that. Like we had brands or companies that weren't even games companies, you know, betting and stuff like that, or bidding, shall we say. And we were all just kind of, you know, on Slack together going back and forth being like, oh my God, did you see this, that, or the other thing? And it got ridiculous to the point, like, I think at one point we had too many followers for like Discord's limit or something like that. So they had to like manually fix it for us.
Oh my God, that's amazing.
And, you know, like, it's just, yeah, it's still kind of surreal. But I think Oliver, our community director now, but manager at the time, had done, I think it's on gamesindustry.biz in their academy section, but a piece that basically said, like, when you can, early on in the lifespan, do like the most creative, fun stuff that you can that just isn't going to scale, because eventually you will hit a point where you can't do that stuff anymore because you will scale.
Yeah, exactly.
So, you know, we worked with our community much before the, you know, the game came out, and did all sorts of fun stuff with them, and just really got a sense for what they liked and what they found funny, and, you know, what they got out of our characters and our sense of humor and stuff like that. And we were able to kind of like build that foundation, which really helps stabilize you once you do hit like the insane numbers.
Absolutely. But yeah, I mean, that's all I have for you. And, but I just wanted to say thank you so much for talking with me. And it's been so incredible to just talk to you about your experience.
Anytime. I think hearing all the crazy ways that people get into the games industry, or like what they love about it, is one of the best parts of working here. So always happy to share my story, and also just to like hear the reactions as well of like what you've gone through or what you find fascinating and all that kind of stuff. So yeah.
That's it for this episode of She Plays Games. Please be sure to follow Haley on Twitter at AbsintheUse. Also, remember, if you want more episodes of She Plays Games, be sure to subscribe and follow me on iTunes, Spotify, and YouTube by searching She Plays Games, and on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at She Plays Podcast. If you want to be on the show or want to nominate someone to come on the show, you can email me at SheplaysPodcast@gmail.com. See you all next time on She Plays Games.